Glad you're all here. How many are planning to do some kind of fireworks in the next 7 days? One? Wow. I got some firecrackers over at the parsonage I'll be glad to hand out to you, because they were actually, the story be told, I've had them in the house probably for 2 or 3 years. It's literally a box full like this. They came from my parents' house. My dad was a big firecracker person, and I'm like, my brother's like, can you get them out of the house? Sure, I'll find somebody. Anybody need any firecrackers? Now, hopefully none of the firemen are raising their hands, but if you do, see me afterwards, because literally I have a box of them. Right away, the kids are thinking, yeah, I could use some firecrackers. That would be fun. Anyway, welcome. We're glad you're here. Just a couple announcements. Thursday, the office will be closed for the 4th. Vacation Bible School is coming up. There's a sign-up sheet for other things. If you have any questions, call the office. Obviously, be inviting your neighbors and your neighbors' kids and all of those. July 15th, Operation Christmas Child Packing Party. And then July 21st, Sunday, is a all-church meeting. Again, the congregation spoke, and the council has responded, so there'll be opportunity, and that information, I think, was in the newsletter of some of the proposals. So if you have any questions, ask any of the council members, and they will say, sure, we have some idea what we're doing, and they do, and that's the exciting part. So I want to make sure, there is another announcement in the bulletin that says Sunday the 23rd. Ignore that one, make sure you're there on the 21st, all right? So we just have to correct that. And those are our announcements. Yes? Okay. Yep, so next Sunday after church, Vacation Bible School meeting following the worship service. If you're a volunteer, or if you want to volunteer, and it's going to be in the evening time frame, so if you like to work with kids, we'd love to have you volunteer for that. All right, those are announcements. We'll begin our worship service with the ringing of the bell and our prelude. Thank you. invite you now to stand and sing with me hymn number 404, The Solid Rock. Sinking sand. I invite you now to join me in the call to worship. The Lord is my rock, my fortress, and my deliverer. My God is my rock in whom I take refuge, my shield and the horn of my salvation, my stronghold. There is no one holy like the Lord. There is no one beside you. There is no rock like our Lord. Be my rock of refuge, to which I can always go. Give the command to save me, for you are my rock and my fortress. Father, we come before you this morning. We're standing on the rock of our salvation, Jesus Christ. It is solid. It is there for us, Lord. And so we ask, Father, that you would be blessed for being with us today. We carry you through your Holy Spirit in our hearts. We are with you, Lord, right now, wherever two or three are gathered. So be blessed, Lord, in our worship, as our desire should be to bless you, and then we receive a blessing again from you. So thank you in Jesus' name. Amen. Please be seated. Hymn number 399, Higher Ground. when the 4th of July is midweek, later in the week, you never know which Sunday is actually the one that we should celebrate the 4th of July. And I mentioned fireworks, and I know there was some in Sherland on Saturday and throughout the week, and it's one of those unique things. But for us, if you take out your prayer list, take that out of your bulletin, I want you to do that, have that right there for you. Doesn't matter what day the 4th of July is, whether we celebrate it on the Sunday or before or the Sunday afterwards. But there's a list of men and women who are serving in our military. And they're the ones who continue to place themselves in the midst of struggles. And so in this case, what I want to encourage you to do is in our time of silent prayer, you pick out a name, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, and be praying for them, whatever their needs are, right now for them. And then whatever name you choose, and if you choose them all, take the whole week. I'm hoping some of you are praying for them every day anyway on your prayer list and that type of thing. But take the whole week and remember that name or that group of names. Just asking God to pour out his blessing on them. I will tell you this, our son Todd is in Germany now. He's on a military base. You all know he's not military, but he's cooking there. But he sent us pictures this morning of the Garmisch, Germany chapel that he went to. They're 7 hours ahead of us, so he's already been in worship and stuff. So pray for these men and women who are on this list, that God would bless them, that God would strengthen them, and yes, that they would make sure they find a church family that they can be part of, chaplain, wherever they are stationed. So let's come to the Lord together in prayer. Heavenly Father, as a congregation, we have been going before you just these few moments here with men and women, Lord, who are serving in the military, who through loved ones here or elsewhere, they are serving and we know their names. Some we know because they're a brother, a sister, a daughter, grandson, granddaughter. They're not just names, Lord. And they chose the service. And so we just ask, Lord, that you would protect them, that you would place a hedge of protection, Father, whether they are in the midst of a fight or doing their duty, whatever that is, that you would protect them. That, Father, you would be their strength. And that, Father, you would continue to open their lives to walk in faith. For some who may not know you as Savior and Lord, that you would find another soldier, Lord, that could be a witness to them. For those who know you as Savior and Lord, that they could be that witness to somebody else. And then I pray for their families, Lord, as they are separated, that you would bless those families. Father, we have a privilege here in the United States of America to be a free people. To be a witness, Lord, to those around us. Help us not to shirk that responsibility. Help us to bask in the freedom that men and women have provided for us for over 200 years. And help us to take on the responsibility of what you call us to as our Savior and Lord, to be a witness to those around us. What a privilege, Lord, we have to gather on this day and the freedom that we have. And we celebrate that freedom, Lord, and we celebrate it, Lord, because we can publicly pray the prayer you taught your disciples. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts, as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power, and the glory forever. Amen. We continue in our worship as we wait on you for his tithes and then our offerings. What a privilege, Lord, we have to return to you that portion that your word teaches us as the tithe. And then, Lord, we can go beyond the tithe and give offerings. And our desire, Father, as a church, is to use these to further your kingdom. So we ask your blessing on them through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. Please be seated.
Matthew chapter 7, verses 24 through 29. Therefore, everyone who hears these words of mine and puts them into practice is like a wise man who built his house on the rock. The rain came down, the streams rose, and the winds blew and beat against that house. Yet it did not fall, because it had its foundation on the rock. But everyone who hears these words of mine and does not put them into practice is like a foolish man who built his house on the sand. The rain came down, the streams rose, and the winds blew and beat against that house, and it fell with a great crash. When Jesus had finished saying these things, the crowds were amazed at his teaching, because he's taught as one who had authority and not as their teachers of the law.
Would you pray it with me, please? As I hear this scripture, Lord, over and over again, I right away jump to the concluding song that we're going to do, but really the song I learned as a child about the wise man and the foolish man. So, Father, that which is familiar for us, I pray that your Spirit would give us insight, would give us understanding, and give us a desire to live how you challenge each one of us to live. Help us that. In Christ's name, amen. Today we come to the end of the series on the Sermon of the Mount, and I have to tell you, though, I say that sort of, because in January of next year, we're going to start a series on the Lord's Prayer. I purposely skipped over that when we were doing this series. So, and if you recall, in 2023, we started with the Beatitudes, started the year out looking at the Beatitudes as part of the Sermon on the Mount. 2024, we went and covered the bulk of Jesus' teaching in the Sermon on the Mount. And now, specifically in the last 3 months, our focus has been on the practical teaching that Jesus gives in the Sermon on the Mount. And it really is no different today, a practical building lesson, how to have a solid foundation. In 1117, the architect Bonanno Pisano began work on what would be his most famous project, a separate standing bell tower for the cathedral of the city of Pisa. You might know it as the Leaning Tower of Pisa. The tower was supposed to be 8 stories and 180 feet tall. One little problem that they discovered at the very beginning, as they had builders, they quickly discovered that the soil was much softer than they had anticipated, and they made the foundation too shallow to adequately support the structure. Sure enough, before long, the whole structure began to tilt, continued to tilt, until finally the architect and the builders realized that nothing could be done to make the Leaning Tower of Pisa straight again. Amazing, so the original architect never saw the end of it. It took 176 years to build, and during that time they did many things to try to straighten what the others did to get the tilt out. So the foundation was shored up. The upper levels were even built to an angle so that it could look straighter on the top. Tower has stood now for over 800 years, but it leans 18 feet from where it should be. Experts say that one day it will fall. And as I was doing this research, I can't remember, it was the 1990s, they shut it down for a dozen years trying to shore it up so that people can still spend lots of money to be able to visit it. The Leaning Tower of Pisa demonstrates quite clearly what happens when a building is constructed without the proper foundation. So as we come to this end of the study of the Sermon on the Mount, Jesus tells his followers how to have a spiritually strong foundation. So this morning I want to share with you 3 steps that Jesus gives to build a strong spiritual foundation. And the first step to a strong spiritual foundation is to hear the words of Jesus. In verse 24, Jesus says, "Therefore, everyone who hears these words of mine." And then in verse 26, "But everyone who hears these words of mine." Now let me tell you, he's making this statement after preaching through chapter 5, chapter 6, and now the end of chapter 7. And he's saying, everyone who hears these words of mine, and here's the great thing, in verse 28 of our text, when Jesus had finished saying these things, the crowds were amazed at his teaching, because he taught as one who had authority and not as one of the teachers of the law. Then in verse 29, because he taught with that authority. I always think of that. You know, he taught with an authority that the others who they've heard now for years didn't have. The rabbis, the teachers of the law in Jesus' day, urged people, just like pastors do today, urged people to hear the words of God and to pay attention to God's law. Well, Jesus urged the people to pay attention to his own words. He taught with the same authority of God and the word of God. And we know because Jesus is God. Now let's go back to verse 24 and that wonderful word, therefore. This is the third usage of this word, therefore, in the Sermon on the Mount. And hopefully you have learned over the years of you being in church that this word, therefore, connects the preceding verses with what follows. Now, what's unique this time when Jesus uses it is it occurs at the end of Jesus' sermon. Jesus is connecting all of chapter 5, all of chapter 6, all of chapter 7. Everything from the very beginning, this therefore meant to summarize and teach a valuable lesson. Therefore, everyone who hears these words of mine and puts them into practice. Jesus is separating his listeners into two categories. Those who put the words into practice and those who don't. When he says, these words of mine, he's including the Beatitudes. He's including those words that we went almost now 2 years ago. Blessed are the poor in spirit, for theirs is the kingdom. Those who mourn, blessed are those who mourn, for they're going to be comforted. Those who are pure in heart, they're going to see God. You can read that on your own. But he's also then telling his audience, remember what I said, you're to be salt and light. And then let me remind you, in Matthew 5, Jesus came to fulfill the law. Then he taught that murder and adultery are sins of the heart before they become sins of the flesh. Then he spoke about the sanctity of marriage and how we are to value honesty, integrity, and to be truthful. We need to practice turning the other cheek, he said, going the extra mile, and not only to love our enemies, but even pray for those who persecute us. When Jesus gets to chapter 6, you realize that humbleness is a major characteristic of the believer in Jesus Christ. Doing good things for the needy in secret. In your prayer, be humble. In fasting, be humble. We were then told the difference between treasures in heaven and treasures on earth. And then after that, as it would be appropriate after dealing with treasures, Jesus tells us not to worry, but instead trust God. And then in chapter 7, he dealt with the idea of judging others. We remember those words, ask, seek, and knock when it comes to prayer. We learned about the narrow and wide gates, the true and false prophets, and the true and false disciples. And I just covered 6 months in 2 minutes, and some of you are wishing that the sermon would only go 2 minutes every week. When I reread the Sermon on the Mount this week, I got to think that nobody in Jesus' day really had a pad and pencil to write this stuff down. They went ahead and heard. Each week, I give you an opportunity to take notes on it. It's in an inset in your bulletin. You see, I learned a long time ago that taking notes on sermons actually helped me remember. Jesus urges his audience to hear his words. He doesn't say, pick and choose the words you like, then just leave the rest. He wants us to hear all his words. He wants us to pay attention to everything and then put them into practice. The second step to a strong spiritual foundation is to do the words of Jesus. Practice his words in your lifestyle. Practice your words in your daily life. When you're walking, when you're running, when you're working, when you're playing, when you're with friends, when you're with when you're by yourself. And it's not a new message. That's the amazing part for me. It's not a new message. When Joshua took over the leadership of the Israelites after Moses had died, God gave Joshua these instructions. It's found in Joshua chapter 1, verse 8. And I'm reading from the Message translation. Make sure you carry out the revelation that Moses commanded you, every bit of it. Don't get off track, either left or right, so as to make sure you get to where you're going. And don't for a minute let this book of the Revelation be out of mind. Ponder and meditate on it day and night, making sure you practice everything written in it. Then you'll get to where you're going. Then you'll succeed. Now let me make a clarity here. Joshua 1:8, where he talks about the book of Revelation, has nothing to do with the last book of the Bible. All right, just want to make sure you're clear on the translators of the Message. All right, the book of Revelation as we know it, 1,500 years later after Joshua was given instructions by God. But God is telling Joshua, the leader of Israel, to not only ponder his word, but meditate on his word day and night. And then Joshua was to practice everything in God's word. And then Jesus goes ahead now and he says, okay, you need to practice this, you need to do my word. And he tells the story of the wise builder and the foolish builder. You probably heard it before in Sunday school many years, and you've also sung about it. Each is going to build a house. They may even have the exact same blueprints of the house. The difference between the two builders is what's underneath the house, and that is the foundation. Last week in my sermon and Jesus' words from the Sermon on the Mount, he challenged us to have a right relationship with him. He made it clear that there will be those on the day of judgment who will cry out, Lord, Lord, like they know Jesus. They're going to cry out those words. And what they're going to find out is Jesus' response will be, depart from me, I never knew you. None of us really want to hear those words. I much prefer these words from Jesus in Matthew chapter 25, verse 21. Well done, good and faithful servants. The difference is the foundation of the rock. One man builds his house on the rock, and the other man builds his house on the sand. The house on the rock stands. The house on the sand comes down with a crash. That's the way I learned it when I was a kid. It wasn't like, you had to make noise when it crashed. From our call to worship, 1 Corinthians chapter 3, verse 11. For no one can lay any foundation other than the one already laid, which is Jesus Christ. In 1 Corinthians 10, the Apostle Paul is reminding the church of Corinth about their Jewish history. And he brings up this time in the wilderness. Most of us who have read the Old Testament and see the children of Israel, and we don't think this way, but Paul understood. It says, they all ate the same spiritual food and drank the same spiritual drink, for they drank from the spiritual rock that accompanied them, and that rock was Christ. Folks, Jesus is all through the Old Testament. Jesus is the rock of the Jewish people. And folks, that hasn't changed in this 3,000 years. When Jesus says that the wise man builds his house on the rock, he is referring to himself. We sang, on Christ, the solid rock I stand. All other ground is sinking sand. 18th century pastor and Bible commentator Matthew Henry said it like this: our hope of heaven is the house we must build. There is a rock provided for us to build this house upon, and that rock is Christ. He is our hope. He is strong, immovable as a rock. We may risk our all with him and shall not be ashamed of our hope. Last week in verse 21, Jesus made it clear that the one who will enter the kingdom of heaven is the one who does the will of his heavenly Father, the one who practices Jesus' words. The true follower of Jesus, the wise man, not only hears the words of Jesus, and he may not agree with them, We may not like them, but the wise man does the words of Jesus. He lives them out daily in his life. Anything other than what we do for the Lord is going to collapse around us. There is nothing in your life or my life that we can count as solid as building our lives on the solid foundation of Jesus Christ. Anything else is sinking sand. I got to tell you, don't be fooled. Money, educations, politics, I'll use the term religion, success, our health, our family, my favorite spouse, my favorite wife. I got to tell you, as wonderful as she is, and she knows this isn't in the sermon, as wonderful as she is, I could lose her. Some of you have walked down that road, and it's hurtful, and it's painful. But the bottom line is, whether it's my children, my extended family, they are not the solid rock, but Jesus Christ is. And there I want to build all of those relationships on Christ. But on their own, they can be sinking sand. Because on their own, they don't provide the foundation when the day of judgment comes. They will help me with the storms of life, but they will not protect me through the storms of life. The final step to a strong spiritual foundation is to embrace the storm. Look, I'm sure I'm not going to be the first to tell you that storms happen in life. Sue managed to get some years back a wonderful weather radio in our house. I know when the storms are coming in Greene County, Rock County, Carroll County, all the counties near us, and it buzzes, it alarms, and it goes ahead. And this past couple of weeks, it kept going and going and going and going. And look, it's a reminder that the storms come near us. In this short little story, Jesus is not teaching about how to build our house in some protected area. No. There are no storm-free zones. Much earlier in the Sermon on the Mount, as Jesus was talking about believers loving their enemies, we heard these words in Matthew 5, verse 45. He causes his sun to rise on the evil and the good and sends rain on the righteous and the unrighteous. Storms don't discern who is a believer and who is not. I've chaplained in a hospital now for almost 18 years. I've prayed with Christians, I've prayed with non-Christians as they've experienced the tragedies that have befallen them. They are hurting. They're not protected because they're a believer. In verses 25 and 27 of chapter 7, describes the storm that went against the wise man's house and the foolish man's house. And it was the same. The rain came down, the streams rose, and winds blew and beat against the house. The storm does not distinguish between the houses. The storm had no idea of the quality of the workmanship or even the foundation. But which one would you want to be in to embrace the storm? In 1992, a TV camera crew was on assignment in southern Florida, filming the widespread destruction from Hurricane Andrew. In one scene, and we've all seen these type of scenes, but in one scene you see the devastation and the debris, and there stood one house on its foundation. And the owner was cleaning up the yard when a reporter approached. The reporter said, "Sir, why is your house the only one standing? How did you manage to escape the severe damage of the hurricane?" And he said, "I built the house myself. I also built it according to the Florida State Building Code. When the code called for 2x6 trusses, I used 2x6 trusses. I was told that a house built according to the code could withstand a hurricane. I did, and the house did also. So when I was writing this, I thought, well, I don't know how to find the Florida code, so I literally Googled how to build a hurricane-safe home. I didn't look up a tornado one, which would probably be more appropriate. So a company called Design Tech Homes out of Texas had 8 tips. I'm just going to share the last one that they had. But simply what they said was tie down to the foundation. A house is only as strong as its foundation. I wanted to look up to see if it was a Christian group or whether they had read the Bible. Then it goes on and says, you can ensure that yours is strong by having it tied together with metal connectors, hurricane straps, clips, and ties during construction. These ties will ensure that the house stays together in one piece, no matter what the weather does. Everything you and I do in life needs to be tied to the foundation of Jesus Christ. And when we do that, we are able to embrace the storms of life. We can't avoid them, folks, but we sure can embrace them. Back to Design Tech Homes, this was in their conclusion of their article, and it's on their website. It says this, hurricanes are a force of nature and can be very destructive, but it's important to breathe and try to relax even during a hurricane. And I have to tell you that when our foundation is Jesus Christ, then yes, we should be able to breathe and relax as we're going through the storm. I didn't say we had to like it. And we can come out of the storm and recognize who He is in our lives. But storm prep begins now. The choices that you and I make today can affect who we are and what we do tomorrow. Your life choices today will affect how you respond to the storms that will come your way, and the preparation really does start from the ground up. As I was reading and preparing, I came across a story that, unfortunately, I believe it's true. And when you hear this, because I couldn't imagine Sue and I doing this story. But this is a story about a Christian ministry organization that was taking a cruise to Alaska with some of their ministry partners. People paid for the cruise so that they could be with this ministry couple. They're going to do preaching and teaching. There'll be music. Your typical cruise, if you've ever seen any of their brochures. On their way back, a storm broke out, and it was the worst storm Royal Caribbean had ever had with that particular ship. The waves hit 50 feet high, plates were flying, pianos were rolling, people were throwing up. It was a messy situation. I should preface this. The husband wrote this story. People were screaming all over the boat. One of the ministry women, he put it that way, but it was his wife, was quite concerned and picked up the phone and asked to speak to the captain. Crew member said, "Ma'am, the captain is on the bridge. He can't talk to anybody right now in light of the storm." She said, "Would you please tell him I'm very upset that he would put us through this when he could have avoided this? He knew it was coming, and I just want to register that I am thoroughly upset about this." You're right, honey. You would never do that. The crew member said, "I will relay this to the captain." And a few minutes later, the phone rang, and it was the assistant to the captain. And this is what he said, "Ma'am, we have just received your message. It was relayed to the captain, and he asked me to call and relay 2 things to you. First of all, lady, go to sleep, because the captain is staying up, and there's no need for both of you to stay awake. Second thing," he said, "was the ship was built with this storm in mind. Long before we ever hit the storm, we knew this day was going to come. We knew there was going to be a day when we would face nature at its most vicious level. So way back when we were putting the boat together, we contemplated this moment, and this boat was structured in such a way that on whatever day this storm came, while it would be inconvenient, it would be irritating and aggravating, while it would be traumatic to go through, what you need to know is all of that was considered when it was constructed. So while the storm is bad, the boat is better. Whatever storms you and I go through as a Christian, when we have that foundation of Jesus Christ, we will always get through. Yeah, we need to hear Jesus' words. We need to be doing Jesus' words. And you and I will be able to embrace the storm and can trust him through the storm. We sang earlier, when darkness veils his lovely face, I rest on his unchanging grace. In every high and stormy gale, my anchor holds within the veil. On Christ, the solid rock, I stand. All other ground is sinking sand. Would you pray with me, please? All other ground is sinking sand. Father, I pray for each one here today. But I pray that they would just be able to reflect on what their life is built on. Is it built on the solid rock of a relationship with Jesus Christ? Or is it built on their own ideas of what their faith should be about, which then just becomes a religion, which just becomes sinking sand? So I pray, Father, that each one here would be on the rock. That's who you are, Lord, our rock. So thank you for that. In Christ's name, amen. Our closing song is, let me find out, how many of you know the wise man and the foolish man? The wise man built his house upon the rock. How many of you know that? Raise your hand higher. All right. How many of you know the motions? Sue and I do. You will. Because in the insert, in the bulletin, it has the motions with it. And we're going to show them to you. So just sit down and relax. We're going to show them, but I'm going to get glasses out to make sure I read them right. So on the first verse, you ready? All right, it says there, pound fist on top of the other in rhythm. That's where Sue has to come in, because it says, the wise man built his house upon the rock. You are building your house upon the rock. All right, and then the rains come down, which means you're going to wiggle your fingers while moving your hands downward. Oh, I do mine this way. Are yours right? Okay. All right. And then palms up and raise your hands in rhythm as the floods come up. The rains come down, the floods come up. How long can you tread water? That's not in there. All right. And then finally, but the house on the rock, fingertips form the rooftop. And then you pound your fist, stood firm. That's the first verse. Second verse. This time, the foolish man's building his house upon the sand. You pound the fist onto an open palm. That's the sand. Helping you with that one too, honey, huh? All right. Then with the rains, you already know the rains. We taught you that. Rains come down. Floods go up. And the house on the sand went smash. Now, you're allowed to yell out smash also. That's what I did when I was little. So it's got to be noisy. Then the final verse. So build your house on the Lord Jesus Christ. Again, pound your fist. Build your house on the Lord Jesus Christ. All right? Then, I got to make sure. The blessings come downward, palms downward, and praying hands up as the prayers go up. Blessings come down, prayers go up, and then fist on top of the other in rhythm and point to heaven for that last thing. We're going to do it, and we're going to do it together. So stand with me. This is where I wish I had a handheld camera so we could go ahead and check everybody out and put you all on YouTube later, but we won't do that. Do you want to play? You want to give us an introduction? Okay, go ahead. You can go ahead and do that cool handle. Excellent job, Father. May our hands, may our words, may our hearts be built on Jesus Christ. And that, Father, may we be a people of prayer. That, Father, and recognize the blessings that you give us every moment of every day because we have a relationship with you. And our lives are built on the rock. Dismiss us now with your blessing, and let us, as the light has gone out, let us be the light of the world through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen.